Well, some people make waves, and here in San Diego, many of us prefer to surf them. And many are making history. Jim Kempton is sharing their stories. He's joining us now to talk about his latest book. Good morning to you, Jim. So good to have you on.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
You know, it's so exciting to have surfing in the Olympics in Tokyo. You know, it's been around for hundreds of years. Women have always been involved, but really I see a lot more ladies out at the beaches these days catching those waves. And I got to say, it looks super cool to see. I love that, you know, women are more involved in this. What have you noticed in doing research for your book?
So we did an exhibit at the California Surf Museum about 12 years ago. And so much has happened since that time that it's just amazing. And the number of women that are in the water now have probably tripled from that period of time. And from the period of the sort of 60s and 70s, it's probably 10 times the number of women surfers. And speaking of the Olympics, you know, Carissa Moore, who won it, you know, she's a Hawaiian, and she could not have been a better representative for the Olympics and surfing than Carissa Moore. Really a fabulous young lady.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's so exciting to see. Watching her on Instagram, it was like so, so cool. And you see so many other women sharing her story. And, you know, it inspires people to grab a board, learn how to surf. Tell us, you know, Jim, you're obviously a man, but you wrote about women on waves. A Cultural History is the name of your book. What inspired you to write this?
You know, I'd been the editor of Surfer Magazine for a long time back in the day, and we'd covered women, but not well. And I just felt like they had never really gotten their due. And women have been such an integral part of surfing from the very beginning that I felt like this was a book that really needed to be written. And and everyone else on this book, from my editor to my publisher to my art director to my my agent to my publicity person and my proofreader, are all women. So I'm just the guy here writing the words.
And you did a lot of research. We were talking during commercial break. I was very impressed by how thorough you were in putting this together. Tell us how you put this together, what you learned in your research.
No, I don't think you could do a book like this before the internet as it is now. The amount of information that you can dig up if you just spend the time to keep, you know, drilling down and drilling down, it's like peeling an onion. And you can go back to original sources. So we have this tremendous opportunity to really find out so much about all the women that we didn't really know about, as well as the ones that we do know about.
And real quick, I know you mentioned during commercial, I asked you about the surfboard behind you, Bethany Hamilton board. Then you can, was she part of some of your research? I mean, who all did you, obviously you can't tell us everyone you talked to, but what were some of the big names that you were able to hear from?
Well, I interviewed sort of all the giants that are still living, for sure. And I had spoken to many of those kind of really important women over the years from the, you know, from the 70s onwards. But yeah, Bethany's board that you see right behind you, you can see the giant bite that's out of her board there. And that's what we call our Mona Lisa here at the Surf Museum, because it's encased in glass so that it can't be it can't be damaged. And people from all over the world come to see it.
Mm-hmm. What surprised you? I mean, when you talk to a lot of these women, some who have become very successful surfing, what do you think people will be surprised to hear about?
I think they'll be surprised at how many contributions women made that I didn't know about, and I don't think many people anywhere knew about. The women who introduced surfing to Ecuador, and the women who introduced surfing to South Africa, and the first woman who surfed in Australia was the first surfer in Australia. And some people may know this, but interestingly enough, and this is a girl right from San Diego here, Maya Gaviera. In 2020, the largest wave ridden by a man or a woman was ridden by Maya Gaviera,
a
74-foot wave. But here's the really interesting thing. When you said surprise, the second largest wave ridden by a man or a woman was ridden by Justine DuPont, who is a French big wave surfer. So that gives you some indication of like where the women have come to, you know, right now in the current state of accomplishment.
Yeah, I did not even know that. I mean, you always hear about men doing exceptional things on the waves, but women obviously are doing it too. Here in San Diego, they're doing it too. So we know we have a lot of great surfers here. I always think of Coco and Izzy, the owners of Surf Diva, because, you know, they brought surf lessons to women all ages. So who here in San Diego made it in the book?
Well, obviously Izzy and Coco made it, and many of the other women who are business people, because I included as many people as I possibly could that are involved with surfing that are women. But sort of the three giants that leap out from San Diego would first be Margot Olberg, who was undoubtedly she was a four-time world champion. She was from La Jolla Shores, learned to surf here, was a wunderkind, and was the dominant surfer of her era. And then Debbie Beecham, who still lives here in the La Jolla area, mm-hmm. Was a world champion in 1982, and she also was the head of the first head of the Women's Professional Surfing Association. The WWSL, the World Surfing League.
Jim, I apologize to cut you off. We only have like a few seconds left. Your event, we want to mention Coconut Pete's Surfboard Repair. It's happening tomorrow at 6:30, a book signing. You'll get to meet Jim, talk more about women on the waves. Thank you so much. Congrats on your book.